We're going to mix it up a little bit. For those of you who joined us last time, you know that we worked on some automatic sketches. So last night we worked on this guy right here, and I used a little bit of fluorescent red dye and some white gesso. That's one of the automatic sketches that I've talked about previously. So laying down gestural lines, creating whatever pops out of them most visually. Today we're going to continue oil painting, but I am switching to a new painting. I thought maybe it would be a little bit annoying or frustrating to those of you who have been following along to watch the same painting evolve. I have been working on this painting for the last few sessions, and instead we will be working on this cat, because I thought that would be a nice change. But if anyone hops in, we'll go ahead and show them the progress of this painting. For now, we're going to be working on this cat right here. And instead of doing the monochromatic process that I worked with on my other painting, we're just going to jump right in with color. I think I'm actually going to start with this bright orange color because it's really going to set the contrast and the color scene for the rest of the skin tones in the cat. So we'll jump in there and we'll probably put a little bit of that color right into the flesh and, you know, inner ears and the nose, just to kind of, and this warm shadow right here on the inner arm, just to kind of start to unify that color environment, if you will. One of the things that's really important if you're trying to create convincing volume in your painting is to include a little bit of the reflective color of surfaces that are surrounding your figure or any forms in the painting. So that's why we will be including some of the orange down on that platform into the cat's body. So I'm going to go ahead and start mixing that. I wanted to try to use only a flat brush this time because I think it would have an interesting painterly quality, but I don't actually own a flat brush, so that may become a goal. If I get, you know, enough support, maybe I'll go out and buy a flat brush. So for now we're going to use just a small filbert, which has a lot of the same properties but doesn't have that flat sharp edge. So we won't get square brush strokes, and I think that's okay. So again, I'm gonna start mixing this orange color. And I'm going to try to use as little oil as possible because the surface that I'm painting on today is paper, and it's just going to absorb basically all of the oil if it's too wet. So I will attempt to avoid using oil, which may mean that the paint doesn't flow across the surface very well, but we'll see. I'm going to use a little bit of yellow ochre and probably some amount of burnt sienna. And we're probably just going to lay down a lot of the tone and not get a lot of texture at first. This is definitely, even though we're starting with color immediately, it's definitely a painting that's going to have to evolve as well. I'll have to let the lower colors cure a bit before we go in with more texture and highlighting. Hopefully the cat itself will be more detailed, if you will, than the surface that it's sitting on. We can at least block in some shadows and light. So burnt sienna and yellow ochre. I'm gonna mix just those two colors together and see if we have a what's close to the local intensity. I'm guessing this is not going to be bright enough compared to the carpet in the photo reference, so I might have to add a little bit of cadmium orange or cadmium red light. But here is our first color. Yeah, you can see that's kind of not red enough. In the stream it looks pretty red, but in person it looks a little too dull. But that's okay, I think I'm actually just gonna run with it. Because like I've said in previous streams about painting, as long as you're pretty close to the local color, you can always go back in and adjust it in slight directions with glazing. Mostly to change the hue. And because we are jumping right in with color and not creating that same base for the other painting, this is going to be one where I try not to overlap the body lines terribly much, because we don't want those colors to mix. They're all going to be wet today. It's sort of a wet-on-wet process, but the paint, again, is very dry because the surface is paper and I don't want it to absorb much of that oil. It's paperboard. Hey, Mikaela! Yeah, I think the hairless cats are great. I think they're beautiful. I know a lot of people get unnerved by them, but I really love seeing all of their skin tones and muscles and bones show through. So that's why we're painting this one. And I switched paintings because I thought maybe it would be boring to watch the same portrait evolve over time. We will be going back to it. I promised last time I was painting it that I would try very, very hard not to paint it off stream, so that I continue treating streaming time like studio time. So I haven't added anything new to it since Tuesday, but I'm setting it aside for a little bit. It's not wet, I just wanted to jump into something new today. This part's gonna be darker, but I'm gonna go ahead and lay in the same color because, like I said, I am just working up the local color of that platform and not necessarily worrying too much about the light and the texture at the moment. It's a little tricky to put the dry paint down because my surface is only connected to the palette at the top, so it kind of wants to flip up since it's paperboard. The only reason I don't like working on unprimed surfaces and paper with oil is that you can see it's absorbing a lot of paint. But at the same time, the one reason that I do like it, and the part of the reason I'm using such a small format in order to play with the process, is that it has a very different visual quality texturally. The paint stays really flat because the paper absorbs so much of it. It almost feels more like gouache or acrylic when you're done, and the brush strokes kind of sit up on the surface more. Thanks! I don't know if you can see it in the camera, but I did use a grid. There's little faint grid lines. I'm pretty sure they're 1-inch squares, so this is like about 16 by 14. And I know a lot of people get down on using a grid to transfer a drawing, but for me it's way more important in these like first exercises to get something that's proportional quickly. Because I mean, you know, you paint, this line drawing isn't really indicative of how you're gonna paint the painting. Like, it's still up to me to create all of those forms and shadows. It's just that the lines help you anchor what it should look like overall. So it's easier to work on the colors and the transitions and shadows than worrying about the proportions at first. Eventually, I would like to just start a painting without having a drawing. What I really want to do is carve out some time this spring to do some plein air painting. Not in the cheesy, like, pastel, washed-out tradition of the plein air school, but just going out into the world and doing some oil painting from observation. But it's not very easy to stream that, so I'll just have to show you guys the results of those experiments, and then maybe down the line, instead of working from reference images that are not my own, maybe I'll take some photos and lay out the underdrawing on stream. I think I'm going to try a tiny, tiny bit of oil just to get this moving a little faster. But you might be able to see on stream, as soon as I start adding the oil, the paper is just going to soak it right up. So I have to be sure that the proportion of the oil is very small compared to the paint pigment. It's just going to be a tiny touch, if I can manage that. A lot like greasy food on a napkin, which is also paper. The one worry that I have is that putting paint with higher oil content onto this paper that has no gesso or primer, I'm worried it's going to soak out and create little halos. So that's part of the reason I'm trying to work so dry. I haven't actually painted with oil on paper, I've only ever used acrylic on paper. So again, this is an experiment. Definitely not close enough to the actual color of that little cat tree platform, but I'm more interested in getting some paint down than I am matching the color at the moment. Mostly I want to lay in that platform color because it's gonna start to set the contrast for the skin tones in the cat itself. If I don't have that color, then if I were to paint it afterwards, it might look like, I just think it would look weird. It's gonna help me identify how much dark and how much light I have to put in the cat. Yeah, oil painting is very forgiving. That's part of the reason I like it so much. It's also part of the reason I'm terrified to use gouache, because there isn't too much room for mistake there, but it is another kind of paint that I would like to be able to use, especially because I work in moleskins and on paper a lot, and gouache seems pretty ideal for that, for quick paintings, for paintings on the go. The paint painting process goes so much more slowly when your paint is very dry. I always forget that. It feels like I'm not making very much progress, but it's because the paint isn't moving with a lot of fluidity. Thanks guys for joining me on this Saturday. In my part of the world, it's Saturday afternoon, so feels like a leisurely painting process. I'm definitely not terribly excited about daylight savings in this part of the world. I am happy to have more sunlight in the morning, but I don't want to lose an hour of sleep. I'm sure I'll adjust quickly. Bodies are weird that way. That's awesome! I'm glad you're sketching at the same time. I feel like I'm becoming a broken record because nearly every time I'm streaming, I'm like, if you feel like being creative and working on stuff, go grab some pencils, go grab some paint. But honestly, that's part of why I started streaming. I watched a bunch of streamers and, you know, seeing them work on particular things and learning about their techniques made me want to start working again. So I would start drawing while watching them. And eventually I was like, wait, I could just treat Twitch as studio time. It's kind of frustrating to me because it means that I can't watch anyone who's streaming at the same time, but most of the big streamers are on often enough that I still catch their streams. Plus, I thought there weren't too many streamers working in oil and paint generally, so I was kind of glad to start expanding that medium in the channel. I'm just excited that there are creative people on Twitch now at all. It's really exciting to see people share their process and engage with their viewership regardless of their skill level. And it's great for me as a viewer, because then I can, you know, hop into a stream and if something's interesting, just ask them a question. Yeah, I know it's so much easier for the digital artists to stream because they need fewer camera angles and they can just stream from their desktop. And it's like, it's a native art form basically. It doesn't feel strange or difficult, and it's not difficult to show the digital process on someone else's screen. But it's true. I really like being able to see traditional artists draw, people who are drawing, people who are painting. I've sat in on some of the like woodworking and sculpture and other craft streams because they're really interesting. Like, I have a personal interest in woodworking and I'm always interested in finding out what kinds of techniques and tools other people are using. And how they actually go about creating their beautiful, you know, furnitures and pieces of furniture and sculptures in wood. But so far, I haven't seen too many of the streamers that have good camera angles, because there are some traditional processes that don't lend themselves well to streaming. Like, I would say, like, casting. If you're trying to show someone how you're carving out like wax casts for mold making, or how you're adapting the negatives if you're doing like silicone casting, that those details don't necessarily translate really well to camera. But I am really excited about all the ways that people are experimenting with that, and the different setups that people have. Like, there's this one painter that I watch sometimes who has a basically just an angle of his palette and an angle, a back view of his entire studio. So you can see the painting in context, you can see the back of his figure, and mostly what you're looking at is the colors he's mixing. And I think that's cool because it means that for him, what's most important is to show the colors. And it's kind of interesting to see what each traditional artist finds important to show. Because it's such a limited space. We only have so much space on the computer screen to show you different things. So like for me, I definitely want you to see the reference image. Yeah, it is very satisfying. I want to get a tiny sense of, well, I still have to fill in this gap right here, but I do want to get a sense of the light and shadow in here before I start moving on to the cat. And I am going to use some of this color to put in the body as a reflected color to kind of unify the color space. I said right at the beginning, I don't know if you guys were in the channel by then, but for me, whenever I'm trying to create a convincing sense of volume and space in a painting, whether it's a portrait or a still life, for me it's really important to get some of that reflected color into the forms that are there. So having this color in the cat skin or in other details in the cat's features leads your eye to believe that that space is really connected to the cat, the cat's really sitting there. So even if it's not the precise color of like the hot shadow that's in here, I'll use my mouse. Even if it's not quite the same color as this hot shadow or the little edges on the nose or the inside of the ears, I think it's going to be useful to use the color in that way. So we'll lay in the rest of the color right here, and then we'll work on some of the shadows, and then we'll get into the cat. And again, even though I'm starting right with color in this painting, this is another painting where I'm not going to use black. There's a really hard shadow in there below his paw. Actually, this is a girl cat. It's below her paw, but I am not going to use black. I try very hard not to do it. For some reason, I just think it flattens out the painting, the color space. I haven't quite figured out why it gives me that feeling. I think it has to do with color theory. So I don't have a good explanation for you, good scientific explanation or technical explanation for you for why I don't use black, but I don't. This is another situation. I talk about this when I am doing my automatic drawings, because when I do automatic sketches and paintings, I'm not using any photo reference. I'm just working with the lines on the canvas and my imagination or memory at that point. So one of the things I always mention is that shadows, if you're trying to create shadows, you should remember that they're the most dense and the most sharp the closer they are to the thing casting the shadow. So in this case, there's a very hard line right here underneath the paw, in the paw shadow. Let me see if I can zoom in on it. This part is feathered right here, and this part is harder because it's closer to the paw. Yeah, I don't know if I ever had a professor that said don't use black, but maybe that is what happened, is someone along the line said don't use black and I just internalized it. But yeah, I really like mixing my own colors for shadows. Most of the time I'm working with really dark, dark colors of the same family, or dark complementary colors. So like if this were just plain orange, it's actually brown and yellow ochre, it's burnt sienna and yellow ochre, but if it were just like cadmium orange, then I would probably use a really dark blue for that shadow. But in other cases, depending on the style and color impression I'm going for, maybe I would just use a really, really dark red. Yeah, I think Mikaela meant discipline. Maybe it was an autocorrect. No, stupid. Nothing is stupid. Mistakes are easy to make. Language mistakes especially. There are so many words that sound like other words. Yeah, autocorrect. The most awkward autocorrect I had recently was my phone wanted to autocorrect, I don't know what the word was, I'll have to figure it out, I'll see if I can figure it out really fast, but it was some very common, innocent word. It wanted to correct it, autocorrect it to fondle, and I was like, no, that's not what I meant, sorry. Oh, stupid autocorrect, yeah. I think we all rail against autocorrect all the time. I don't remember. Do you remember what you auto-texted to her? Also, I think that I figured out the right balance of music and speaking. There were a couple streams where people said that my voice was getting drowned out by the music. If it still feels that way, let me know and I'll adjust some things. But I think the balance is okay now. Sometimes I get annoyed by sites that compile images of text conversations, like messenger conversations or text messages, between, you know, parents and children or friends. But I really have a soft spot for all of the terrible and embarrassing autocorrect ones. And definitely changing people's words in their dictionary is one of my favorite pranks, as long as, you know, the person that you're pranking has good humor. Thanks, Mikaela, for the audio feedback. Alright, that's pretty close. I think I'm just going to try to bring in a little highlight on the edge here and a little patch right there, and then we'll start adding color to the cat. Cat color. I might have to get some Indian yellow in here at some point to drown out the white, because right now I'm just using white to bring a highlight tone. But you can see it's like drab because we don't have a primer, we don't have any gesso, there is no underpainting, we're going straight onto paperboard with oil paint. And if I add white to yellow ochre, and burnt sienna, it starts turning into a flesh tone, which is not, definitely not the highlight color in this little carpet square. I just want a lighter tone in there. Actually, yeah, I don't know that I can find my Indian yellow. I'll have to do it, I'll have to bring those highlights back on the next stream. The cat, of course it dances. Can you imagine this cat not dancing? I am gonna also drop in a shadow right here and maybe add a little bit of shadow there. I'm gonna use burnt ochre, burnt umber, because it is a pretty red, dark brown. So like I was saying, instead of using black for dark tones, I prefer to use very dark complementary colors or very dark colors of the same family. This is definitely a very different tactile experience, the dry paint on the paper. Because it's so dry, it's not letting me mix it the same way I'm used to on primed canvas. Which is fun. I like that as a challenge to kind of overcome the nature of the brush strokes and the way that I'm applying the paint. Yeah, I bet this cat has serious moves too. I love cats that have like really, really animated jumps and hops when they get excited or vocal, when they're like meowing at you and they jump around. That's what this cat would do. This is another image that came from Reddit Gets Drawn, and the brother cat, it was a sibling pair of cats. The Reddit user and owner posted an image of the brother and then posted an image of this one. So I can imagine them getting into antics together. Alright, I think that's pretty sufficient for that base color. So I'm gonna put some of the orange in places where I think it belongs in the cat. And then I think I'm gonna start with darks instead of lights in this case. And we'll mix up some of those really great purple tones, some of those kind of dusty pinks, a little bit of gray, but mostly purple. This cat is purple and pink. Trying to think about where my Indian yellow would be in my studio, because I think the yellow ochre isn't bright enough, especially for like the passages in the inner ear. Yeah, the cat has the keel bone. Yeah, it's true. It's interesting how similar animal bodies look when they don't have fur covering them. It looks very much like the chest cavity of a chicken. Alright, so there's some bright in here. Yeah, that's just not bright enough. I think I'm gonna have to add some cad red. Which of course I have misplaced. Of course. Alright, I have to duck to the corner for a second to look for some paint. Alright, I got cadmium orange instead of cadmium red and yellow, Indian yellow, which, if you don't know, used to be, I forgot my palette, hold on. Indian yellow used to be created by feeding a particular kind of animal the plant or fruit that had the pigment, and then they would dry out the animal's urine and collect the pigment for paint making. That's not how they make it anymore. I dropped my brush. I'm just all over the place today. Okay, got it. So we're gonna mix in some of the Indian yellow and the cadmium orange to get some of those bright oranges in the cat, inside the ears and on the nose. Fortunately, I was able to get these tubes open with my cloth instead of my teeth. I will continue to remind you, don't chew on your paint tubes. Most of them, especially the cadmiums, are full of very toxic heavy metals, which is why I was really upset. I saw earlier today on This Is Colossal, which is an art and design website. They feature, you know, cool things that they see every once in a while, or, you know, on a consistent basis, but they feature cool things. Right now, one of the artists they featured does finger painting with oil paints, which is really bad. She does not use like little finger gloves or gloves at all. She uses her bare fingers and the paint, which I can definitely understand as a desire. One thing she talks about is having a really interesting tactile experience with the painting process, and being able to exercise much different control over the forms and the technique. But it is ill-advised to coat your fingers with heavy metals for long durations. Even here, I'm like trying to get, you can see my tube is kind of crusty. I'll show you this one. Yeah, no, neither one will focus, but there's a lot of crud on the tube, which makes it hard to open over time. And I don't even want to clean it off unless I have like a little toothpick or something. I don't want to put cadmium orange underneath my fingernails. Don't chew on your brushes. Don't chew on your paint tubes. Try not to finger paint with oils. Alright, we've got Indian yellow, which is a really bright, transparent yellow, and cadmium orange. And I'm gonna mix it with a little bit of burnt sienna to try and get that very vibrant orangish color. Alright, we're gonna try the nose since it's most prominent. It's too dark. Definitely too dark. But that is definitely a good color for the inner parts of the ears. I'm gonna zoom in on those ears while we're painting them. They've got such great folds and light in there. Those are details that are probably not going to show up very well in this first round of painting, because I need paint on the surface before I can add paint with more oil. I think actually because the skin tones are so purple, for these shadows in the ear, I'll probably either use very dark red or very dark violet. I'm gonna try alizarin crimson and see if that's dark enough for those shadows. I suspect it will not be. But at least it gets us towards the darkness. I added a little bit of white since this has such lightness. There's so much light showing through that ear that those tones are actually pretty light. They might just be more grayed out. But I want them to fall back a little bit, so I added some white. It's an interesting challenge to figure out how to get those ears very smooth in their color transitions while still having the brush strokes be super apparent on the paper because it's so dry. There's a lot more challenges for me personally than I thought there would be, so I'm glad about that. For any of you who are just tuning in, I'm working with fairly dry oil on paperboard. And normally I'm working on primed wood or canvas. So this is an experimental painting meant to expand my understanding of the medium and the surface. It's not an experimental painting in that I'm not using any wild techniques or colors or the content isn't that weird, but it is a learning process for me, and hopefully interesting for you guys. If any of you create, feel free to jump in chat and tell us what you're working on. Mikaela is drawing while watching, and I'm fairly certain Red Lazarus is or has been drawing alongside the stream as well. I'm just so excited to get into all those purple tones. Those purples and grays. This cat has so many colors. Toxic Terrorist, your assigned color is like neon green, so I think I got your name right. Toxic Terrorist 487487. It is such a cute cat. I was telling Mikaela agrees. It's a cute cat, regal cat, beautiful cat. I think they are beautiful. I mean, even just looking here, like if you isolate any form in those cats, they're like flowers, they're beautiful, they're full of color. You can see all of their muscles and their bones. They're supposed to be delightful to pet, they're like suede leather. I think they're gorgeous creatures, and I'm really enjoying painting this one. Thank you for the follow, I really appreciate it. If you haven't been here before, this is a new oil painting. Last time when we were painting, I was working on this oil portrait, and then on Thursdays, we mix it up and do some automatic sketching, which is very gestural and more graphic, and definitely more experimental. There's another one that I created on stream. So, two very different styles to offer here on Twitch. That's not the painting we're working on right now. The cat is. Yeah, 15th follow! I wish I had a tiny prize for you. Thank you! I really appreciate the compliment. I will definitely tell everyone that while I feel like I have a pretty good basic understanding and, you know, good control over the technique, I don't necessarily consider myself good as an artist. I don't have a very strong voice or a very strong style yet, and that's part of what I'm trying to work on by streaming, is getting towards, you know, what colors I enjoy using most, what kinds of painting techniques are most comfortable or interesting to me. I'm working towards developing a style and feeling more like I can call myself an artist. And in the first few months at least, in the very beginning, I'm mostly going to work from other people's images. So this cat is not an image that I took myself, it's not a cat that I know. In the channel description, you can find a link to Reddit Gets Drawn, which is a really great resource for images. That's where most of these images are going to have come from. So this is a Reddit user's cat, which I am painting. Aw, thank you, Toxic Terrorist. Oh yeah, I definitely know what furry art is. I have a few friends who are furries and who make a lot of money on commissions. I have a friend who actually builds fursuits. Those are megabucks. And for any of you who don't know, the furry convention has a home in our hometown. We're out here in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. They flock to our city, and we welcome them. They're always really nice people, you know, friendly. They patronize our businesses. They don't trash our convention centers or business venues. They're all really nice, and they have lots of money, and they spend it liberally with people that enjoy their company and are nice to them. We are pretty lucky. I'm glad that even though we're a little city, we still get a diversity of people passing through here. I myself am not a furry, but I can completely understand why people get drawn into the culture and the fandom. We are talking about furries, Critter Monster. I was just mentioning how Stephanie, creates fursuits, and we've got the convention. Oh yeah, no cons in Glasgow. Yeah, that's tough. It would be tough to be far away from a place, or from a, you know, yeah, it would be tough not to be able to engage in the culture that you find interesting. Hopefully you can still make connections out there and maybe visit a con someday. Furry life. You know, I have exactly one complaint about furries generally, and it is that I have never seen a fursuit of a non-cuddly creature or a classically ugly creature. So I haven't seen like beetles or moths or I don't know, like fruit bats. Maybe it's just because the suits are harder to construct, but it is weird to me that for at least for the subset of furries that feel like they identify with the animal personally, or you know, were that animal, or have that resonate with them, it's weird that there's a very narrow window of animals that seem to be most popular. It does have fabulous ears. They're like flaming flower petals. They'll get toned down once I get the grays in there. But I love cat ears. One of my guilty pleasures, admission on stream, one of my guilty pleasures is very gently biting my cat's ears. He's very patient. They're just so soft. Alright, so we definitely need to start getting some grays in here. I think I'm gonna add a little bit more of the orange to the shadows in the arm. So these shadows down here where the skin comes together in those little folds. I'm going to start adding some of the orange in there. And then we'll move on to all of these beautiful violets and grays. Yeah, Nashville seems like a pretty good city to be in. Very vibrant with music and culture. Pretty tolerant in a lot of cases. Everyone should do it at least once. Maybe twice. And of course I mean chomping on cat's ears. Get your minds out of the gutter. This is Twitch, we are family friendly. Just kidding, personally I don't think that sexuality should be off limits for, you know, family discussions. Everyone should be informed. Everyone should learn. Discussion should be more open so that we are safer and more healthy in our practices. Aw, thank you. I do err on the side of kindness. It doesn't make sense to hate on people. I've heard that your weather is actually a lot like our weather in that it's like always gray and maybe raining and maybe snowing and maybe cold and maybe dark, but also maybe all of those things all at the same time every day. That's our winter at least. I would bet that's tough. If you ever get the chance, you should come to our con because we've got all kinds. The furries that I know are all queer. I think I might have to, let's see. Trying to figure out how to show you guys the pause, because I just realized the Twitch alerts are over the area that I'm painting. So I'll try not to paint this area too much. I'll focus on the upper body, but I am gonna lay in some of that shadow behind the paw really fast. Alright, so we've got our little warm shadows and cat pits, cat arm, inner arms, skin folds, and we're gonna start mixing some of those very warm, or not very warm, but very cool violets and grays for the rest of the body, especially in the ears. I think because I started on the ears, we'll just continue there and work down, especially because, as I've mentioned in previous streams, I do really like working in layers. Even though this is a very dry painting, it's an unprimed surface, it's oil paint, so the paper is absorbing a lot of the paint and the brush strokes are pretty prominent. We're still gonna work in layers. So I'm gonna continue working on the inner ears and then maybe some of the eyes. Hello, Speed Cheerio, welcome to the stream. Yeah, 6 people hype, that's pretty big for creative. At least for, you know, the first week or two. Do I do furry concept art? I don't, actually. I'm not a very graphic artist. I know that those automatic sketches look pretty graphic, but I can't draw that way if I try. I don't have a very flat graphic aesthetic. I know there's some that are a little bit more rendered, but I don't do it, and a lot of people, I mean, no one's ever asked me either. I think it would be fun. It would certainly help me pay the bills if I could do that as like a little side practice. Alright, so a little bit more in the nose. I'm gonna bring some of the yellow into that nose. Like I mentioned, this is a little bit too dark, so we're gonna lighten it. If I can. I'm using primarily white and Indian yellow. Thanks, Speed Cheerio. Do you make work yourself? I always like to ask people who are stopping by if they create art or just like to watch art. I might try. It's something I would consider. Like I said, Tuesdays and Saturdays are oil painting, and then Thursday is kind of free game, whether I'm working on drawing, other kinds of painting, so that would be an opportunity to try a different genre too. I've mentioned, some people have asked if I do any digital work. I would really like to become proficient with digital tools, so I have thought about maybe doing some digital art on stream, except that I'm so bad. It's really, really bad. But of course, then I look at all the other, you know, painting streamers, and I'm like, my art is terrible. Why am I streaming? Why? Why am I doing this to myself? And I have an answer, and that's because I am here to improve and learn. Twitch for me is like studio time, except that I also get to hang out and chat with all of you lovely people. Critter Monster, who is in the stream, actually kind of inspired that, because the way we became friends is I would work on art, and they would stop by and be friendly and gently pester me to be social, and it just stuck, and we're very good friends, and that's kind of how I feel Twitch is. There's all kinds of people passing through, opportunity for new and interesting conversation and productive dialogue. So even if I don't feel like I am necessarily qualified to be streaming, or amongst the best creative streamers, I'm glad to be here, and I feel like it's a productive time for me and anyone else who is enjoying themselves. Indian yellow, yes. I'll show you the paint tube. It doesn't look like that. I'll open it up. If any of you are not oil painters, I had to scramble around my studio to find this color because yellow ochre is kind of greenish and wasn't doing the brights in this cap justice. So I have this really kind of bright, transparent yellow. It's actually, if you mix it with white, it's a lot like the yellow of my sweatshirt. And it used to be created by feeding leaves or fruit of a particular plant to a particular beast of burden, and then the pigment would be distilled from that animal's urine. That's not how they make it anymore. It's a synthetic color anymore. That's great. What kind of concept art? Like video game concept art or world building, or we were talking about furry art. Do you do furry art? Toxic Terrorist is very interested in anyone who makes furry art. That's awesome, Critter Monster. I know I was supposed to help you reorganize, so at least you can do it while I'm nearby. Alright, I have white and Indian yellow. Alright, we're moving on to the darks. We're getting some violets mixed up for the edges of the ears and then the inside of the ears. And the way that I'm going to do that is by using alizarin crimson, one of Bob Ross's favorite colors, burnt umber, and toric gray, which is another pigment I love and will tell you about on stream. Toric gray, made by Gamblin. You can actually get a full-size tube of toric gray paint every year from participating art stores. The tube is free, and it is because the way they make it is it's part of their environmental consciousness. It's sort of their effort to reduce the waste of the environment, the waste byproducts of their paint creation process. They scrape up all of the pigments that have collected in their filtration systems and in their factories. They scrape up those pigments, they homogenize them, and then they create a gray out of them. And it's the most densely pigmented gray I've ever worked with. And it is really fun to work with because every year the proportion of the different colors that go into the color is slightly different. So when you mix it with white or black or any other color, it always has a slightly different property year to year. It's kind of an unpredictable paint, and I think that's really fun. So I have some really dark grayish color for these edges because I know that some of that pigment is going to be soaked into the paper. And it's going to be easier to lighten it at this point than it is to darken it. So I'm just going to scrape that over the side of the ears. Ha! Painting with urine. Well, it used to be. It's not anymore. That is expensive. I can't imagine. Well, I can't imagine because paint supplies and art supplies are very expensive, but I can't imagine spending that much money in one sitting. And I know that they're worth it, having seen people construct them. It's a lot of work. What is your fursona, if I may ask? Or do you have multiple? I am an art nut. I like art. I like art and I like materials and tools. I will go on equal tangents with, you know, warehouse organization or, I don't know, mushrooms. I really like mushrooms. Critter Monster knows how much I like mushrooms. So that's something we will definitely have to do, is paint some mushrooms. The grade does have a vintage. I actually wish that I had the year. Let me see if it has it. This one doesn't say what year it was, but all over the tube it says promotion, not for, you can't read it on camera, but it says promotion, not for resale. It's their Earth Day pigment, so it's on Earth Day that you can get the free tube of paint. And the other cool part of Torrid Grey is that every year, you have a few months between Earth Day and the end of the contest, they have you, they allow you to enter in their painting competition. So you can use Torrid Grey, white, and black only to create a monochromatic painting and enter the competition every year between Earth Day and the middle of August. You've only used your, you've only used your fursuit once? Critter Monster, I've adopted a particular kind of mushrooms as a symbol for, poly relationships, actually. There's a kind of, here I go again, nerding out about mushrooms as I did about pigments. There is, and I'm forgetting to paint. Okay, we're gonna paint, but, there's a kind of mushroom, a kind of a category of mushroom called ectomycorrhizae. They are mushrooms that form symbiotic relationships with the root systems of a couple different tree species. So wherever the roots come together up from those trees, you'll find the mushrooms growing there. That's where their root system takes place. And they will scrape up a lot of the nutrients that are drawn from the soil by the roots of those trees, but in order to promote the health of that network, of that little ecosystem, they will actually redistribute nutrients and sugars back to the trees. So if one tree is getting too much, it will take a little bit and push it onto another tree, and it also makes sure to keep enough nutrients for itself so that it can sustain its own growth. And I like that as a symbol for poly relationships and intentional community. You know, you're trying to redistribute your emotional resources and your personal resources so that your overall community has great health and lives well. That's cool, that's a good use of your suits, actually. It's true, I am very passionate about the things that I will nerd out over. So this is definitely too dark. We're gonna bring in some light violets now. And I think, actually, I'm gonna use Pain Gray. This is my preferred bluish color, actually. Bob Ross, if you watch Bob Ross on Mondays or you have ever watched him in your life, on public broadcast or otherwise, is a big advocate for phthalo blue, but phthalo blue is very strong. So I like Payne's Gray. It's a gray that has a little bit of a blue tint to it, and I find that it makes much quieter blues and purples if you're interested in that. And in this case, in the cat skin, those violets are pretty quiet. They're more like gray. That right there, that's not gray. That's a little violet. Has the tiniest bluish purple tinge. So if you used phthalo in that case, it would just be like a big blue spot. So I want a gray that has a blue tone instead, which is what Pain is good for. So Pain Gray, probably some white, probably a little bit of Torrid, and definitely Alizarin Crimson because it's a cool red. Dragons are fun. A dragon suit would be fun to make. I think dragons are fun to draw too. I've had a few lizards in my lifetime and they have come to unfortunately tragic ends. But I love dragon, lizard, reptile, dragon scales, and the way that that is both, you know, fluid, flexible skin and little, tiny scale armor. Our friend who does create suits and goes to conventions was telling me her routine for staying hydrated whenever she's in a suit, because our summers get pretty hot. and our convention center is not very cool with so many people inside of it. But that's intense. The whole procedure you have to go through to maintain hydration while you're in a fursuit. That's some dedication right there. So you've got a little bit of violet. That'll go on the inside of the ear too. This interior part is kind of a pink color, but this shaded part is violet-ish. Oops, I made a paintbrush stroke outside the ear. I don't have a post office box, but I do appreciate the offer for art supplies. Yeah, Thalo is very, very, very powerful. Until you use it as a paint, you're like, oh, okay, it's blue, it's probably okay, but it's blue and then you add some white and it's still blue and you add black and it's still blue and you add red and it's still blue. It really overpowers almost any other pigment that you try to add to it. But for that reason, it's one of the colors that I like using a lot when I'm doing monochromatic painting, because it will hold its own no matter how light you mix it and no matter how dark you mix it. So if you're using black and white and phthalo, you get a really nice distribution of that blue tone in your monochromatic paintings. I might do a bearded dragon tribute painting, but I think it would just make me sad. Wow, those are big, big wings. I'm having trouble imagining what they could be made out of without being really heavy. I mean, I have played with foam as a base for other kinds of costumes and sculpture, and even though it's basically made of, you know, air and little bubbles of air with minimal material, that foam gets heavy when you have enough of it. If you're talking about Quaxum, Quaxum's not here. At least I didn't see them on the viewership. On the viewer list. Although I haven't checked the viewer list, I don't know. Thanks for joining me, all of you people. I don't know who any of you are if you're not talking, but I hope that you're enjoying lurking. I know a few people who are participating in chat are themselves drawing while they talk with us here and watch the stream. If you ever feel inspired to create things, don't think about your talent. Don't compare yourself to others. Just grab some pencils or paint or whatever you like using and make some stuff. Remember, if you feel like you don't do something well, you can just do it for yourself. You don't ever have to show anyone else your work. If you enjoy just drawing circles on a piece of paper, if you enjoy putting black paint on some cardboard, any activity that makes you feel very connected and very present and just at peace is a good thing to be doing. And you don't have to compare your skill to anyone else. Sometimes you just make things for yourself, and that is enough. But if you are interested in sharing it with other people and you are interested in improving your techniques, just by doing it over and over and over again, making things with consistency, you will improve because you'll learn about your materials. And if you're, you know, studying things, if you're sketching from observation, or you're even just trying the same thing over and over without any reference, you are going to improve because you are practicing. Yeah, that foam is better. That foam is light. I tried using like, what was I using? Like upholstery foam. It's really thick and really dense, so it holds shape really well, but it's very heavy. I have so much paint on my palette now that I keep losing my color. I'll show you guys really fast. There's paint everywhere! What color am I using? I keep forgetting, it's right here. I know a lot of artists like to work in kind of a chromatic way on their palette. They'll lay out a bunch of colors and then either white or whatever other colors they're using to create tones, and then just create little columns of the shades of the pigments that they're using. But the reason I have small dots of color all over my palette is because I like to conserve my materials as much as possible. So there's really only 3 or 4 big dabs of color on there, and the rest is little strokes that I've been mixing. All right, I'm gonna start to bring in some shape in the eye because I keep getting distracted. Chatting with you guys is just too much fun. And I'm supposed to be working on this inner ear, but I don't have a light gray yet. I'm not a furry, but you know, we can still be stream friends. You can be my best stream friend. Best 15th follower stream friend. Yeah, like a Pollock painting. All right, get ready chat. Here comes another tiny art nerd tirade. So Jackson Pollock, for those of you who don't know him by name, he's pretty prominent. Most people know who he is in the art world or outside the art world. He's that guy that had really, really big paintings that just have drizzles all over the surface, and he liked to use house paints and industrial paints, so not fine art paints. And he was often categorized along with the action painters. And he's also the artist that people point to most often when they're like, oh, my kid could make that painting. I could make that painting. That's not real art. He's very divisive in terms of people with art opinions. But the coolest thing about Jackson Pollock that nobody knows, well, hardly anybody knows, is that he wasn't just... He gets lumped in with the action painters. The action painters had a lot of focus on just using their materials gesturally, getting a lot of paint on the canvas, making sure that their marks were about the movement and the action of putting paint on the surface. That's what the action painters were about. Pollock was actually very, very, very interested in Native American sand painting as a meditative act. So his first works, if you go back and look through his art history, his personal art history, his first works are actually like really figurative and very close to the style of those sand paintings. They have symbolic references, they're more controlled in their technique, and so he was working through this idea of using Native American art as a source of inspiration, and like an appropriation in his artwork at first. And he did it in a meditative fashion because he was also dealing with a lot of addiction and alcoholism. So he would treat his painting as a kind of meditative spiritual activity. When he finally went through a period of sobriety, he broke himself from addiction. He didn't remain unaddicted for the course of his life. He did go back to being, you know, an alcoholic and struggled with other substances down the line. But he had a brief period of sobriety, and he expressed that he found clarity, and that is exactly when he started making those big, drippy action paintings. And if you look at the first few of those drip paintings, there's still a lot of reference. There's a few of them where if you diagnose the direction of the strokes and the forms of the colors carefully, diagrammatically, you can see that it's like almost a copy of another sand painting that he used to reference really often, even though it looks like a bunch of drips and scribbles. And so for me personally, Jackson Pollock is actually one of the best examples of art that is no longer appropriation, but art that is like cultural fusion and evolution, because he stopped using the sand painting as his style. He stopped doing that. There are a lot of people who would say he should never sand paint because he's not part of that culture, and it is a spiritual, personal experience, and you shouldn't do that lightly, especially if you're not part of the culture, if you're just doing it as imitation. But he took that process, he explored it for its own merits, and in a pretty respectful manner, and then he moved away from it. He derived exactly what he needed to from that process, and he expanded on it for himself. So he's my favorite secret non-appropriation artist. And I think it's really cool that his work is actually very embedded with his own personal spiritual journey, and that there is way more intention in those drips than anyone gives him credit for. I don't know that any of them would stream, my furry friends. I have one that I'm kind of trying to convince because she makes these really beautiful watercolor paintings and she builds fursuits. I think it would be good for her to stream that process. But it's also kind of an investment. It's not easy for everyone to stream if you don't have a good internet connection or you don't have the money to buy the webcams and stuff. You don't have to buy super fancy webcams, but I did splurge a little bit on the one that's focused on the canvas so that it has better resolution. Hey Coxum, I'm glad you found a better internet connection. I know Biddles was giving you trouble. Yeah, Mikaela, it is really amusing to see people try to recreate Pollock, and I think it's because of all of that meditation and intention and exploration that he did in order to create them that is why people can't reproduce them with the same resulting quality. I'm not a big fan of Jackson Pollock's paintings, but I like the process and the story behind them. Visually and materially, they're not super interesting to me, but they do have their place in art history. So I finally have kind of a middle purple gray, and I'm trying to fill in all of those spaces that I left light in the ears so that you can start to feel the actual contrast in the colors instead of these really pretty bright plumes of flower petal ears that we have going on. Toxic Terrorist, you have me very self-conscious of my American accent. I really, really love Scottish accents. And now I'm like, my voice is terrible. I can't talk on stream anymore. Anytime anyone outside the United States jumps into chat, I get really worried. Oops. It's gonna be tough at first to build the strong contrast in the ears and in the body because the background's still white, so it feels like the brightest thing in the painting. So it'll seem a little bit dull until we can get that color in there, which will probably be next time, but I might also go ahead and just lay the background in background color in off stream because it's a plain color. It's not something, it's not like an environment. It doesn't have shapes and forms or figures. So it would be a little, I think it would be a little less interesting to watch me just paint one color on the back of the painting. I may do that off stream before the next time we paint the cat. Hey Mocap, welcome back! We got another follower who is sharing your text color right now, your name color. I switched over to the cat because I thought people might get frustrated if I kept painting that other portrait for too long. So he's gonna wait until Tuesday or maybe next Saturday. Actually, not next Saturday. I have not terrible news, but sad news. I have to suspend my stream for about a week. I have to go to California. I'm in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I have to fly to California next week between Friday and the following Friday. So there will not be a next Saturday stream or weekly streams the following week. But I will be back. I will be back one Saturday from now, or no, two Saturdays from now, we will resume the stream, and I'm still on for all of this next week, except for Saturday. It's the cat of a Reddit user. I'm not sure whose cat. I don't know the cat personally, and I don't know the person personally. This is another reference image from Reddit Gets Drawn. One day I would like to have one of these cats, but I also kind of can't justify the cost when I could just go rescue a cat, or multiple cats, as the case may be. So we need more of the violet up in the head. I like those little head wrinkles a lot. They're gonna be fun. I think I'm going to mix a little bit of a dark gray to start laying in this. And I know that I said I'm going to work on the eyes very soon, and I am, because they are a lower layer. And we're still working in layers. So actually, maybe I'll go ahead and do that now. I'm going to lay in some of the eyes. We'll zoom in on them. So this is mostly torrid gray and a little bit of brown. There'll probably be some blue or violet in here eventually. Actually, I'm gonna mix some Payne's gray, which is that darkish blue gray. Thanks, Critter Monster. Everything is definitely okay. Mocap, we spent a lot of the stream talking about how so many people think this cat is ugly and we all think it's beautiful. It does look like a bat, but I also like bats. I think bats are also very cute. I think just for fun, I'm gonna make that shadow, the shaded eye, pretty dark purple. I think it'll give it a little bit more depth. So, I mean, it's not strictly for fun. I have chosen with great intention to paint this eye with a deep purple. Quixam, are you at Elisa's? Okay, because I know she's having a coloring party later. Pizza party! I don't actually like pizza, but I hope that you're enjoying it. Yeah, completely understandable. But I do appreciate you stopping by. Your company is always welcome, everywhere and anywhere. Red Lazarus, I know you like pizza. You like pizza too much. Aw, come on! Mocap, seriously! I know you said you don't like it. You haven't said that again, but I keep thinking about it. How can you resist those little jowl folds? This cat has so many adorable wrinkles. It's so cute. If you don't want to watch because the cat's ugly, I completely understand. Anyone viewing, if you just can't get over your aversion to these cats, I knew it would be a divisive subject matter. It's not everyone's cup of tea. But I do hope that you're enjoying our talk about painting and artists. And you could always jump in chat and ask me some art questions to distract yourself from this ugly beast. Have fun! Bye, Quaxon! Bye, Critter Monster! Both of you should enjoy the day! It does have hair, actually. Really, really, really fine hair. barely any hair. It doesn't really seem like it has hair, but it has like a layer of cat peach fuzz. Thanks, Red Lazarus. It does look like an alien, but I like that. I think I need a smaller brush shortly to get some of these lines in. I feel like we should have a chat poll. Ugly cat, beautiful cat. I'll start off 10 votes for beautiful. Beauty is certainly in the eye of the beholder. Yeah, Red Lazarus, you can also have 10 votes. You're like the cat ambassador in the channel. Now you know I distribute points unfairly when it has to do with cats. Alright, we're back to needing a tiny, tiny bit of oil. Again, only a little bit because we're on paper, unprimed paper, and it is eating my paint. Oh, that's a good idea. Excuse me while mocap distracts me. With this pole. This is the disadvantage of not being a digital artist. My keyboard is not right in front of me. Here you go. Here is the official Rigel Fish cat poll of the day. We're pretty much tied now. Come on, guys. Tell me about your cat feels while I make up these cat shadows because we've lost the cat reference. Just 2 votes? It's totally rigged, I told you. Unequal distribution of cat points. Thank you. Oh, beautiful cat! We're winning! I don't know, mocap. I think that you're gonna lose this one. All right. We've been voting long enough. 3 votes. Beautiful cat. I'll check in a little bit and see if anyone else votes. Feel free to repost the poll link every once in a while. I definitely want to get some of that green-yellow color in there soon. We need some very dark nose color, which is going to be mainly tauric gray and a little bit of probably alizarin crimson. It's kind of a violet. Right here, that little nose highlight, that is like the one exception for using phthalo blue. Because phthalo is such a strong pigment, if you ever need bluish highlights or purplish highlights, it's a very good candidate for making a highlight off white. Furries forever! Oh, I didn't include furry as a poll option. Missed opportunity. I never would have guessed. This cat has too much white in its eyes. That doesn't look like a highlight yet. I need a tiny brush. It has very people-like eyes right now, human eyes. It's probably part of the reason it looks like an alien. This needs to be a little circle. Slightly better, and this one needs to be toned down. got a sharp eye corner. I don't know if I can get that sharp corner with this dry paint. We will try. Ugh. I need a stiffer brush. They have like the brush strokes have kind of a sketchy quality because they're so dry across the paper. It's a little better. The sound of dry brushing is really satisfying. It's like a scrapey noise, very gentle. All right, I think I'm gonna give that lower lid a red-brown highlight. Are your keys broken? No, I do that all the time when I get really excited. Or when I switch between computers because I have a different kind of keyboard at work than the one I have at home, I misplace my hands all the time. I never learned to type properly, so I still touch type, or don't touch type, whichever one is the technically incorrect version of typing. I can't find, you know, can't find those home keys without looking. I almost type individual keys all the time. So I make a lot of mistakes. All right, we are quickly approaching the scheduled end of the stream, but I'm really having fun, so I'm gonna keep going. We'll set a tentative end time for 5 instead of 4:30 and then see how we're doing then. I'm sure Red Lazarus is chuckling right now to know that I'm extending the stream time because right before I started I was like, I don't want to stream. I don't want to stream today. I was being, you know, lazy, childish. This is a consistent schedule, guys. I am working here. And I think that's actually really important. It's important to, if you're dedicated to something and you really want to get better, that you sometimes you have to do it when you don't want to do it. This is not just play, this is work for me. This is skill building. If I want to improve my art actively, then I have to make things on a consistent basis. That's part of the reason I chose to start the cat instead of working on the other portrait, actually. It was like an incentive for myself to get moving. Like, okay, today you can make all these cool purples, interesting purples. That's an incentive to keep streaming. I do kind of get worried that I'll feel like overwhelmed, or not bored, but I feel like I hope that this doesn't happen, but I worry that I'll get inconsistent or lazy about streaming. But I want to do it for a long time. Because it's not about anything except for having that scheduled studio time for myself and then meeting you cool folks. Thank you, Micaela. I hope you can join us again another time if you're headed out. Thanks for stopping by today. Tripod is right by my foot, so apologies. This part's kind of blue. It's like a very light, very, very bluish violet. Which again is not going to show up very well on stream as a color and a contrast because the background is still white. But that's okay. Yeah, that's really, really a good idea. Digital studies are awesome, and I hope that you learn a lot from your process and have fun. So I'm laying in a lot of that pinkish violet tone, the light one, just to try and get color across the whole surface of the cat face. I still have to go back and accentuate the darkness on the nose and the forehead, but I think it'll be a little bit easier if there is that light tone across the rest of the surface. And I keep trying to paint the ear, but the ear is out of view, so I might switch focus in a second. For now, we'll continue with this violet light color. Now that I do have this tiny brush, I'll also go back and add more detail to those darks, but I want to work on the lights first. For any of you who are just tuning in, if you're interested in how we're creating this very light violet tone, it's with a little bit of Toric Gray, some Alizarin Crimson, some Payne's Gray, Payne Gray, and white. And I'm trying very hard not to use very much oil because the surface is unprimed paper and it's just gonna soak up the oil And I'm afraid that it's gonna produce halos of oil, because I've never worked this way before. If any of you have, and you have any suggestions, insights, please let me know. I was putting the light first, and now I'm jumping back and forth. As always, I say I'm gonna do one thing, and then I get distracted and start doing something else. So now we're back to darks. I was working on the light first, but then I mixed a slightly darker shade and jumped over to the shadow side. To the dark side. And I'm gonna grab some reddish brown for the ear right here. I lost that little ear flap right there somehow. I think it's mostly just like right behind. Okay, now the dark here is too dark, so we're gonna even it out. With more of that light purple-ish, which I can always make darker. I mentioned this right at the beginning of the stream, but a lot of the cat's details are not gonna necessarily be very finished at the end of the stream, because I'm mostly interested in getting a lot of the local color down, the color that is in that area, and not so much the detail. I might actually break out the phthalo, but I do have another kind of, I have a tube of phthalo here. I would use the phthalo blue only for this little tiny ridge of highlights on the face, because it's a highlight of a very purple violet area, and so it's either going to be a very, very light violet highlight or a very light bluish highlight. And in this case, phthalo is so strong of a pigment that I think it will bring those highlights forward with effectiveness if I mix just a little bit into some white. Oh yeah, and I'm sorry for moving the camera. Now I'm pressing really hard on the paper surface. Try to stabilize it a little bit. Toxic Terrorist, what's the question for? That's too broad of a question. If you stick around today, and if you stick around into the future, you will find that I am a very honest, open person, and I will at least entertain most questions, but you do have to ask me a specific question. Mikaela, who left us, seemed like she and a couple other Twitch users were being trolls the first day they were here, but we actually had some really good conversation about, you know, body and gender politics and sexuality. And they were not trolls, and now they watch. can I get any furries to like you? I think that is something that, unfortunately, you will have to do on your own. I'm willing to bet that if you meet any, they'll like you. Are there really no other furries in your area, or have you just not been able to find them? I know you said that there weren't conventions, but are there also not furries? I mean, I know there's not like a website, glasgowfurries.com, but I feel like there's some amount of, that the community makes some amount of effort to try and connect geographically. None! We should just post all over furry forums. Wanted, one furry friend in Glasgow. There's gotta be at least one more. Although that's a small selection group for friends. There's only one more person. Yeah, it's just a matter of finding them. That's tricky. There's certainly more density on mainland UK. If you can call it mainland. But it would be nice to have a friend in your own community, I'm sure. Alright, I'm gonna move up to the upper part of the ears. Yeah, definitely too much time and money. But, you know, down the line, if it's something that's very important to you, you should definitely consider it. Or, you know, consider whether or not it's cheaper to go and visit some conventions abroad. Because maybe there are folks who are actually closer to you, who do travel, and you'll accidentally connect with them. Or not accidentally, but you know, through circumstances. That would be really funny, actually, if the first time that you meet another Scottish furry is when you are abroad at a convention. That happens really often with Pittsburghers, actually, who travel. Native Pittsburghers, because of their class, don't often travel outside of their city, because not everyone can afford it and not everyone is interested in doing it. But I've heard more than a small number of people go to some distant place, you know, go across the United States, 2,400 miles away. They go into some small restaurant or bar and they hear their native accent from across the way. And they strike up a conversation and are like, "Are you from Pittsburgh?" And they say yes, and they, you know, start sharing exactly where they're from, and it turns out they live just down the road from each other, but they had to go across the country to meet. least you can attend that convention in a few years. That's something to look forward to. Meh. You want furries now. That would be cool. Do you have any hesitations? Is there any reason you wouldn't do it? Yeah, it is pretty awesome. The friend that I mentioned who makes suits and is herself a furry actually does performance art with her suits. She makes suits specifically for her performances, but she was recently at the Prague Biennial wearing some business wolf outfits. I'll see if I can find a link really fast, actually. I thought they were pretty cool. She updated her portfolio to include them. Yeah, here's I don't know if she has, oh yeah, she does. She has performance photos and also all of her concept art. Yeah, bad people, but bad people are present in almost any fandom and convention setting, you know? Bad people exist everywhere in the world. They're a danger. For anyone who's clicking that link, just in case you are at work on this Saturday, it is not safe for work. Not the business wolves, but other portions of the website. She doesn't use YouTube either. She hasn't really documented her process more than her creative work, her fine artwork. She documents those as performances, but she hasn't put her creation process or work up on YouTube or any other platform. I still think she should. But not everyone is interested in it. Understandably. It's true, everyone does think furries are for sex immediately. But as with any activity or interest, there are all kinds of people doing it for different reasons. Yeah, I bet. I think it would be a popular format to share her work. Wow, Alright, we're finally starting to get a good coverage of color in that forehead, so I'm going to start to go back and bring in some of those darks, the little wrinkles and stuff. But first, I'm going to get these last few patches. It's kind of hard to see on the stream, but there are still some patches without any paint. And I'll finish out the face here too. If you can find her contact information on there, I'm sure she would be interested in talking about her work with you. She is always interested in doing more work abroad eventually too. So, you know, I don't know that she would go to a con, but she is usually one of the vendors tabling at our con. Oh yeah, I didn't even notice it was almost 5. And it's gonna feel weird. Every time I come to Saturday stream, it feels like an eternity between now and Tuesday. For the first week, I had so many audio problems that I ended up streaming almost every day. I was on Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And then when it came time to wait until Tuesday, I was like, wow, feels like I haven't streamed in forever. But for me, it's important to take breaks because I don't want to get burnt out on it. Yeah, everyday streams are good. And if Mocap's still here, Mocap encourages me to stream more often. So that I have more consistent viewers and more viewerships if I'm interested in getting partnered. And that is something that I'm interested in down the line. But for now, well, I'm just starting to get back into it because I haven't. These few things that I've made are like the first paintings and drawings that I've made in about 2.5 years. So for me right now, it's more important just to start building good habits for myself and being consistent rather than doing it more often to get more viewers. Plus, I actually really like having a small number of viewers at any one time because it means that we can have these conversations. I mean, I'm sure if you've jumped into any of the big creative channels or definitely any of the gamer streams, it's like the Wild West out there. It's kind of chaos. I don't think she posts her phone number because it's expensive, but I feel like her email address is there somewhere, and that's probably a better way to get into contact with her anyway. If you can't find it, I will ask her if she'd be interested in chatting with you. She also does some amount of taxidermy work. I don't know if you've looked through the rest of the website, but she'll incorporate a lot of taxidermy blanks and materials into her works. And on occasion takes commissions from people to take furs and pelts and make them into garments. So she had some guy pay her to take a bearskin and make a vest and coat out of it. And she's made wolf hats and all kinds of stuff. Right now she is in the midst of grad school applications for performing art. So if she gets into one of those schools very shortly, she'll be quite busy with her own work. But I think she'd probably be interested in talking to other people who share interest in the fandom and the process, especially if you have your own suits. You know, you can bond over the construction and the materials and the costs. I think she just started a company called the Pittsburgh Creature Shop. I'll double check. I don't do landscapes. That's actually one thing that I want to do more of, is get better at creating spaces and landforms and those kinds of elements. I gravitate more strongly towards figures in fields without much detail, but I think that's kind of detrimental. If you've looked at my other work on my portfolio, then you know that I work a lot with nude figures and really big figures. Actually, there's a piece in there that you might be interested in. I think I can link to it directly. I don't have a finished version on my website. That's okay. That is perfectly fine. Right, if I didn't want you to talk about furries, then I would kick you. And I'm not gonna kick you. It's harmless, productive conversation. It's what you're interested in. And if you're here hanging out with me, I'm interested in what you're interested in. I guess you could say that a lot of my work kind of has overlap with furry work, in that I am often using animal-human hybrids. So this one especially, I haven't finished it. All the pieces are in my attic for the big pieces. So I was thinking actually about painting these on stream. That I think is like the closest to furry work that I would do, you know. It's all mostly about the human figure more than it is about the animal figure. But they're still anthropomorphic and hybridized. I am not going to post my email. You can definitely find my email on my website if you really want to. Or if you want to submit a public link to the chat, I do allow links. I'm gonna put some of the wrinkles in the forehead up here, down. Yeah, Pittsburgh Creature Shop. Thank you, Red Lazarus. And again, anyone who's clicking that link, that's not safe for work. I should probably add the tag when I'm actually typing in the link. I'll remember eventually. Little skin folds. They're almost like tiny cat battle scars. But those figures that I was talking about are so big that I don't know how I would be able to paint them very well on stream. I think it would be hard to capture the process and the detail. And it also requires a lot of paint, which is part of the reason I haven't finished them, because I never know when I'm going to be able to afford more oil paint. For that reason, for really big paintings, I actually kind of drift towards using house paints and industrial paints, because I'm not especially concerned with the preciousness of my painting. I mean, those are painted on insulation foam, so if I was worried about long-term conservation, I wouldn't have even created them. With 70 cameras. Matrix style, we'll just do a circle around the painting for the entire stream. I'm gonna add more dark to the nose. Yeah, if you don't mind sharing it with them. Actually, you can whisper now on Twitch. I can't remember the whisper convention because I don't play WoW or any other game with chat that allows you to whisper, but they just sent out an email. If you want to upload your image to a public or a personal album on a public website, you can whisper the link just to me. Let me see if I can find it. And you can do that in chat now. You were able to do that with a user outside of the chat window, like through their channel somehow, but now you can do it directly in chat. I'm looking for the whisper thing. I can't find it. Maybe someone else with a keyboard in front of them can pull it up for you, but there is a way. Where there's a will, there is a way. You could use Imgur. You could send us a Drive link if you want, if you use Google Drive. Yeah, TinyPic is a very good option. Not very many people use it anymore, but it's still good. It expires, right, MoCap? The image isn't hosted after a while? I seem to remember that being the reason it was so popular to begin with. Alright, we've already surpassed 5. I think that I can probably paint for like another 15 minutes, but then I do have to go take care of some other things. So 5:15 is our new end time for anyone just jumping in. And again, the next stream will be on Tuesday. We'll probably continue painting this cat. I might jump back to the portrait that we were working on. Kind of depends on how I feel that day. You are my fan. You're my best fan. Best 15th fan. But But there are plenty of other really great creative streamers to watch while I'm not around. You should check their work out. Just to rep a few that I watch consistently, there is Kathleen Illustrated, who does these really adorable Adobe illustrations in Illustrator and Photoshop. She actually works at Adobe. Kathleen Illustrated. Sometimes I watch Ink One because he's got a really great brand of tough love. He does a lot of drawing work related to his tattoo work because he's a tattoo artist. On Wednesdays, we watch Slick Entertainment Inc. If you've not watched him, it's delightful. He paints really fast on Photoshop. He creates things very fast. He does all of the art assets for a game that Slick Entertainment Incorporated is producing, a little Viking game. A lane-based action-adventure game for mobile. Who else do I watch? Molten Ink, also on the Adobe channel. That's great, I do want to see it. We should figure out how you can share it with me. If not today, then keep it on your mind, and the next time you tune in, we'll figure out how to get you that link. Or get you to send that link. I love seeing what other people create. And for anyone who's watching, I am really very interested in giving creative feedback. It may be slightly boastful of me, but I do think that I'm very good at constructive criticism, constructive feedback. I think there is merit and room for growth in every skill level. And that if you are doing something that you like, something that brings you joy, something that helps you find flow, which I've mentioned before, if you are unfamiliar with the concept of flow, I can go over it again. But if you're doing something that you like and you want to improve that, then you know that process has merit. It doesn't matter how skilled you are, how long you've been doing it, what kind of art you're doing. I am interested in helping people grow. So if anyone ever wants creative feedback, I'm interested in providing that. If we ever get lots of viewers in here all at once, then it may end up behind a paywall, but for now, I'm pretty open about it. Oh yeah, that's tricky. Double email step. Sometimes I do that, actually. Sometimes when I'm using Instagram, this is really silly, actually. Sometimes when I'm using Instagram, I can't get a quality photo on my phone, or I don't think it's good enough, like the color is off, or it's not capturing enough of the detail on the... It's not capturing enough of the detail of the drawing, or the painting, brush strokes, whatever it is. Sometimes I'm dissatisfied with the quality of photo that my phone takes, so I will grab my camera and take a picture, and then upload it to a desktop computer, and then email that picture to myself, and then download it on my phone, and then post it to Instagram. So it's like the same kind of circuitous route, except opposite. I have to send stuff to my phone and download it to my phone before I can send it to mobile applications like Instagram. I feel like there are probably apps that do this for me on the desktop, but I haven't actually looked into them. Because my janky rerouting has been sufficient. Alright, we'll probably add some blue to this guy next time, and certainly more pink in the cheeks and the mid-tones, but I think we're starting to get some pretty good definition. Like I said, it may be the case that I lay in the background color while no one's watching, because I don't think it's very interesting to see me paint white all over the surface for a long period of time. I'm gonna put some dark underneath the chin a little bit and start giving the definition to the face. Those little dark jowls. Dark cat jowls. have to leave. I must leave. Although, mocap, I keep taking your suggestion into consideration to do more streams, more days. I think I might start streaming Friday nights, even if it's a short period of time, because there's just so many people on there, and that last week was definitely the most active day, was Friday. So I'm strongly considering adding Fridays to my stream, but we will see. For now, it's the same schedule. And again, I'll post an official announcement somewhere on social media, maybe also on Twitch. I'll probably create a temporary banner, but I will be gone next Friday through the following Friday. So I'm especially apologetic to you, Toxic Terrorist, since you just joined the fun. Just joined our school of artfish. You only get 2 more days until you have to wait so long. But that's why you should check out some of those other cool artists. I know, so sad. Thank you, mocap. I'm glad you enjoyed yourself. Thanks again for stopping by. It's always nice to see you. Okay, sounds good. I will hold on. We still have 5 minutes. I will wait at least 5 minutes. Start extending some color down into the neck with this tiny, tiny brush, which is highly ineffective, but has been good for kind of smoothing out the color on this rough surface. Seems to be a little bit more pink down here. I shouldn't have put so much cadmium orange on my palette. I didn't use very much of it at all. But with big tubes of paint, it's kind of hard to get very little paint out of the tube. You can email me. Let me see if I can figure this out. Hold on. All right. You must prove your dedication as a viewer who wants to send me a photograph. You have to go to my portfolio and then look at one of the copies of my resume. My email is in there. Because I don't want to post it to chat and I can't remember how to whisper. It seems silly because I'm telling you exactly how to find it, but there you go. That's my caveat. It's the challenge, the art challenge. Become an art adventurer. Quest to find the email. I don't know if that worked. I see my name highlighted, and that's all. Red Lazarus, can you jump in and confirm what the last chat you can read is? Hopefully he's still watching. Yeah, so that's certainly not Whisper. I think it might be /// or /. Yeah, but I told you. Yeah, I didn't give you the specifics, but I did say what city. My partner actually gets really, really nervous about that, so I try not to say it so often. Because I don't want him to feel bad. It's tough though, because I'm such an open person. All right, we're past 5:56. We're past 5:15. No, toxic terrorist. Oh wait, yeah, you meant it. Try it again. I will give you 2 more minutes. That looks like a whisper. Let me see if I can work on it. That's actually not where I live anymore, so that's good to know that my address is wrong. You do have my email. Yep. It's lies. It's definitely not lies. That's the correct email address. Oh, you mean my address. Ha, huh, yeah. Well, I told you, I haven't made anything in like 2.5 years, so it means that I haven't updated my portfolio either. Oh, all the music disappeared. It's like it knows that I have to stop streaming. I'm waiting though. Yeah, that's correct, except that it's a period, not a comma. One of the streamers that I just mentioned a little bit ago that I watch is live now. So if you're interested in watching someone else after I sign off, consider watching Ink One. Yeah, that is it, except you have to replace the comma with a period. I could host them, but honestly, hosting is only interesting if you're kind of a high-profile Twitch user, because you want to send a lot of viewers over to that channel. Host with 5 viewers? That sounds so weird, guys. Why would I do that? I think it's only for people who have a lot of viewers, or people who are friends. At least that's how it seems like people use it. Wouldn't it be weird? Only 5 people are like, We're watching this tiny streamer. Hello. Plus, I don't want to host anyone before I host my good friend, Old Toby. As soon as I get enough consistent viewers, then I'd like to host him for a while. He plays games. Ink One also plays games, so actually, I don't want to host him unless he's drawing. I don't know if he's playing games right now. Oh, I have an email. Oh no. It's not from you. Still waiting. I'm still painting. We're still here. There's no music, but we are here. This ear needs an edge. Yeah. I don't think I would host until I have a lot of viewers. But it would be really funny. Oh, yeah. That'll take a little while. I'm still waiting. Don't worry. We're super spoiled with our internet here. We have fiber optic service. So if you knew our upload and download speeds, you would probably cry. It's a thing that I often take for granted, but I know that I should not. Three pieces. Do you want me to talk about them on stream? And is it okay if we show other people, or do you want me to just look at them myself? Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. I feel weird responding to your whispers, but for anyone who's interested in creative feedback, that's what I mean when I talk about constructive criticism. Constructive criticism is not nice, like, oh, this is lovely, I love it, everything is perfect. Constructive criticism is balanced. You point to the strengths of the work and the things that you like and the things that pop out as being very strong and good. But you're also very honest about the ways in which you think that artists can improve. Because the only way that you're gonna know, that you're going to be able to grow as an artist is to have feedback from other people, from the people that are viewing your art, from the people that you want to be your audience. You want to know how they relate to a piece, how they feel about it, what it looks like. So if everyone is only ever like happy, nice, and handles you with, you know, padded gloves and never gives you honest feedback, that's not useful. At the same time, the reason it's constructive criticism, constructive feedback, is because you're not attacking a person, you're not telling them it's terrible, you're not, you know, putting them down, or, you're not being mean, you're just being honest, and you frame it in a way that they can relate to on art terms. You know, you talk about the technique, or the use of color, or proportion, or whatever is important to the artist that you're talking to. When they ask you for feedback, you should be meeting them on their level. They have an idea of what they want to hear. You know, is my color good? Are my proportions right? Is this something that seems like an overall good composition? Does it look realistic? All those kinds of things. So if someone asks you for feedback and you're willing to provide it, that's a very important thing to clarify with the person you're talking with. Because sometimes they don't want specific information, like, the thing that I always like to talk about is the quality of color in people's work, because that's something that's very important in my artwork. But not everyone is working on their color. Not everyone wants feedback on how they're using colors or how their use of color could be improved. Sometimes people just want to know, is this striking? Or do you think that my proportions are accurate if you're trying to do a figure drawing? So, Again, if you're interested in providing feedback to someone, always clarify with them the kinds of things that they want to know so that it is a very productive session. So it's productive for both you and the artist. My download speed my download speed is 150 megabits. Our upload is usually 170. But that's on Ethernet, not Wi-Fi. And part of the reason we upgraded is because there are multiple streamers in the house who stream in parallel. And so far we have 2 streamers. We could grow to 3 streamers. So it was important for us to have a bigger data capability. Really, really great speed. Great speed. I'm very happy about it. It's expensive, but for us it's been worth it. It really feels like living in the future. Because before this, our max was like 5 megabits upload, or 5 megabits download, and 0.3 upload. In that case, if you use Google, I'm not sure what email account you use or what media service you use, but if you use Google, you can share things through Drive that are bigger and they sometimes go a little bit faster. But I'll keep painting. I like painting. If I didn't like painting, I wouldn't do it on stream. We'll just have to paint in silence. This is meditative painting. Quiet, reflective time. Yeah, if you use Gmail, then try using Google Drive. While we're waiting for your stuff to upload, because I went on that tiny tirade about asking the artist what kind of feedback they want. What kind of feedback do you want? You know, are you interested in your color? Are you interested in proportion? Are you interested in the concept? Because that's another thing. I went to school. I actually did go to school for art. I didn't start in art, but I landed in art. But my program was a conceptual art program, so there was a lot more focus on the artistic intent and the impact of the work and the kinds of conversations the work was creating between artists and the art community more than there was focus on like technique and proficiency and color and composition. It was more about art ideas and art impact and to some extent art importance than it was about fine art or illustration or those kinds of things. Attachments are tricky. You could try sending one piece at a time. If it's 3 different images, just try sending each one in its own email. I don't mind getting multiple emails. Then while the other ones are sending, we could probably start talking about one. I know mocap, you're probably like, you should not offer creative feedback to people who are not subscribers. But again, we're very early, we have few viewers, we're not popular yet, so I'm gonna do it. Eventually, it may be a privilege, but right now, it is more of an honor that you want to share things with me. And I really do like seeing what other people create and talking to them about it. If I had the opportunity to be an arts educator, I would consider it. I just don't think that teaching is something that I would be very good at because I'm very much an introvert. Thank you. CC means you're copying someone and they can see the content of your email. BCC is you're blind copying, so they can watch what happens in an email, but the main person you're sending it to doesn't know that that's occurring. They can't see the person in the BCC field. So those are usually used on like business emails where you need to hook in a supervisor or someone who's training and you want them to watch the transaction, but you don't want the person you're sending the email to know that that person is watching the course of the conversation. You are not dumb. No one is dumb. Everyone is learning. Okay, no, that's not true. There are some people who are dumb, but that's a whole other conversation. The difference between ignorance and dumbness and intelligence. I have strong opinions on this, much like mushrooms or pigments. Did you try TinyPick, like MoCap suggested? Because you can upload an image there and then it produces a tiny URL or a URL for you to share it publicly. Yeah, what is this, 95? Some places it is. The internet is unequally distributed. No worries. But I am gonna draw a hard line at 5:35. You can come back on Tuesday, or you can send me the image between now and then. If you can manage to send it to me before Tuesday, I will definitely look at it and I will email you back and give you my thoughts. And if you want me to talk about it on stream, I still will. We can still show other people and they can weigh in with their thoughts as well. Especially if Critter is here that time. Critter and I, part of our friendship is very much art-based, so we're always giving each other feedback on our work. That's okay, you can figure it out. Take some time, send it to me. Like I said, I'll give you feedback through email, and if you want me to talk about it on Tuesday when we paint again, I definitely will. All right, thank you again, Toxic Terrorist. You're still in Whisper, I don't know if you mean to be, but thank you so much for the follow. Thank you so much for conversing with me about all the things that interest you. And thanks everyone else for tuning in. I really, really appreciate it. Yeah, that might work too, but I definitely have to go. I'm sorry now. So yeah, thanks everyone else for joining me. I hope you all learned a little bit about painting, if that is interesting to you. I hope no one fell asleep during my lecture about Pollock. Can expect similar such lectures and tirades in the future. Hopefully they're all a little interesting. I've really enjoyed being here, clearly, because we have streamed a full hour past my end time. It was really nice to talk with all of you, and I hope you have a great rest of your weekend, and that you continue making whatever it is you make, or watching whatever it is you want to make or watch. Thank you, bye!